My pleasure to welcome all of you to the second talk of the IACS seminar series. So I am Hari Narasimhan. I'm a postdoc at the Institute for Applied Computational Science. Just a brief intro into who we are and what we do. So the Institute for Applied Computational Science is an institute within CS, and we sit in the building opposite the road in the Northwest building. So our main focus is on training graduate students in various aspects of computational science and to equip them with the right set of computational tools to solve real-world problems in science and engineering. So the Institute for Applied Computational Science organizes a seminar series every term. So this is organized, a talk is organized once in every 2 weeks. And we try to cover various aspects of computational science, ranging from data science to machine learning to applications in finance, in science, engineering, and whatnot. So with this brief introduction, let me call upon Trevor David Rohn to come and introduce the speaker today. Thanks.
I'm Trevor. It's a great pleasure that I have the honor of introducing Professor Tsuda. He's a professor at the University of Tokyo in the Department of Biological and Sciences and Medicine. I met Professor Tsuda about a year ago, where I did some research in his group. I found there that he was really at the forefront of his field in materials informatics, and I had a really fantastic time. So for this reason, I'm also quite happy to have the pleasure of introducing Professor Tsuda. Professor Tsuda started his career with a PhD from Kyoto University in Japan. And after his PhD, he went on to do some nice work in Germany and also in the United States, including at the Max Planck Institute for Biological Cybernetics, where he started out as a research scientist and then eventually became a project leader. In the year 2006, maybe 4 years ago, so quite recently, he started as a university professor at the University of Tokyo. The talk is titled Machine Learning for Material Discovery. Thank you.
Thank you for introduction, Trevor. And my name is Koji Tsuda, and I come all the way from Tokyo. And actually, my talk is not so technical, so. So I have been doing research of machine learning for about 20 years, and I have been working in bioinformatics for 10 years, more or less. And recently, I started the materials informatics project, maybe from 3 years ago. And I will talk about basically materials informatics problems. And I think you are the mixture of computer scientists and maybe physicists and experimentalists and so on. So I think this talk will interest you somehow. So first of all, I came from this Kashiwa campus of University of Tokyo. Actually, University of Tokyo is a very old university. It's more than 100 years old. But this campus is pretty new. It's like 10 years old, and it's in the suburbs of Tokyo. And actually, I started my lab in University of Tokyo from 2014, and about half are non-Japanese people. And actually, we are doing mostly bioinformatics studies, but we have more and more fraction of materials informatics because it's really like hot topic these days. And the reason that it's a hot topic is this materials genome initiative by the United States. And actually it started 4 years ago, I think, 2012. And what it says is that the goal of this project is to somehow reduce the cost of materials discovery. So it says they make the time to develop materials by half, just half, by using IT and machine learning and so on and so forth. So, I mean, because the US started something like this, so maybe, you know, also Japan has to follow. And actually, China has a very similar project, and so on. And now, you know, almost all countries are trying improve material science using IT and machine learning, data science, etc. Yeah. And of course, the discovery of new functional molecules and materials are of national importance. So particularly, Japan has strong material science sector compared to other fields. Like computer science is not at all strong. So, I mean, it's a shame. But material science is one of the strongest field of Japan, Japanese science. And actually, the difference of materials informatics from bioinformatics or chemoinformatics, I think, is this first principles calculations, the existence of first principles calculations. And actually, first principles calculations are physical simulation that allows you to compute basically the energy of crystal structure. So given some crystal structure of materials consisting of several atoms, you can basically compute energy of this structure. And because of that, you can compute various properties of materials very accurately, actually. And it's based on quantum physics. And actually, there are about five kinds of them. And accurately, actually, it's very important to know that there are several levels. And actually, full configuration interaction, full CI, is the most accurate one, but it's very slow. So its computation takes n to the power of 27. So it's really terribly slow. So it can be applied to very small systems, like consisting of two atoms or three atoms or something like that. And the empirical potentials method, which do not use quantum physics, is very, very fast. It's linear time. So there's a huge difference of computational complexity among these methods. And actually, the middle one, density functional theory, is about has cubic complexity and n to the power of 4 complexity and so on. So this is, DFT is the most commonly used ones. I mean, at least for metals and ceramics and these things. And actually, this kind of computational physics studies have a long history. And so far, it's used in a way, I mean, in that kind of way. So it means that experimentalists find new materials of having new properties. And then they just talk to computational people, the simulation people, to verify this. So this is a very traditional way of collaboration of experiments and computational physics people. And maybe in the future, in the very, very near future, like in 2 or 3 years, it will be transformed in this kind of form. Artificial intelligence method drives simulation and experiments to discover the space of materials and to discover new materials. So this is some picture in my mind. And actually, I will show several case studies which partially realizes this. And actually here, so actually when you want to search new materials, there are many, many candidates, many, many possibilities. So for example, which atoms to combine and something, and how, you know, the fraction of these different atoms, and so on and so forth. So you have really countless possibilities of new materials, and then you have to search in this material space to come up with new materials. And so far, it's very much about hunch. So, you know, very skilled chemists or physicists, you know, come up with some ideas and then make new materials. So this is very traditional way. But at least some part of this discovery process could be replaced by artificial intelligence. And I will explain three techniques. And one is virtual screening. I will explain details later. And I report our study about discovering low LTC compounds using virtual screening from a database. And LTC stands for low thermal conductivity. So therefore, it's good for, I don't know, separating heat from outside, and so on. And it's also useful for building thermoelectric materials, which converts heat to electricity. And the next one is Bayesian optimization. So if you are familiar with machine learning, now Bayesian optimization is very, very popular in machine learning field to, for example, to optimize hyperparameters of deep learning algorithms, for example. But it can be also applied to materials informatics. And I will explain about two case studies. So one is about optimization of grain boundary structures. And the next one is automatic design of silicon germanium nanostructures, which may be the most, the closest to the pictures last slide. And I will briefly introduce our software called Combo, which is the first Python library for Bayesian optimization. And lastly, I will briefly talk about Monte Carlo tree search method, which is necessary for very large problems, so to tackle with really large space of combinations. And actually, Monte Carlo tree search is a standard method for computer Go. Do you know the game of Go? Like, it's like chess, but you have like black and white stones. So it became really famous due to this AlphaGo, the success of AlphaGo of Google. And actually, this is AlphaGo is a combination of Monte Carlo tree search and deep learning. But I will explain this later. And actually, we are also trying this to develop new materials, but also it can be applied to design RNA sequences. Okay. So suppose you don't use machine learning, and you want to identify the best material among 10 material candidates. And then, of course, what you can do is to calculate the properties of materials scores for all candidates. That's it. And then you can identify which one is the best. I mean, this is obvious. But if you have only 10 candidates, probably it's possible. But if you have, say, 10,000 candidates, it becomes very difficult. I mean, especially for fast methods, it should be possible. But they are like higher rank methods, and they are very slow. And even if you use a cluster machine, it takes some time. And sometimes it takes 1 week using 100 cores to compute only one value. So it's hardly, for computer science people don't do this kind of computation, but physics people do. So this is often not efficient enough. So what you do in virtual screening is first you compute scores for a number of, for part of candidates. And then using this as training data, you run some machine learning model, and then you just predict the scores of the rest. So that's virtual screening. Then, of course, training machine learning models and also computing predictive scores are really cheap. So you can really cut the cost of calculations. Really large margin, like 100 times faster or something. And I will report our studies of applying virtual screening to search for new thermoelectric materials. And actually, basically, thermoelectric materials can convert heat to electricity. So this is very important to for environment, protect the environment, because you can use excessive heat from factories, and then you can just really generate electricity. And the goodness of thermoelectric materials is defined by this figure of merit, S squared sigma divided by kappa times temperature, T is temperature. And S is called Seebeck coefficient, and sigma is electrical conductivity, and kappa here is thermal conductivity. So basically, if you find some materials whose kappa is small, then this can be a great candidate for thermoelectric materials. And actually, this is a pan sold by a Japanese company, and it uses thermoelectric materials. And the idea is that if you make a soup, right, and then you can charge iPhone. I really want this. I mean, this is great for, earthquake kind of scenes. Because you don't have any electricity in this, but. I mean, this is one case, but thermoelectric materials are really very important kind of materials that many companies are trying to make. And then this is a motivation of our study. So I was collaborating with Isao Tanaka, who is a professor in Kyoto University, and he actually developed a system capable of calculating lattice thermal conductivity, LTC. Actually, thermal conductivity consists of electrical lattice thermal conductivity and lattice thermal conductivity. So lattice thermal conductivity is part of thermal conductivity. And so actually, I don't understand very well about what it means, but they are very good at they are physicists and theoretical physicists, so they can build such a system. But it's very, very slow for screening in large database. So as I told you, one LTC computation can take 1 week using hundreds of cores. So maybe it's possible for hundreds of compounds, but if you go to large databases, like tens of thousands of compounds, it's, it takes years. So. But actually, this computation is remarkably accurate. I'm surprised because I'm a computer scientist, so I don't know physics. But this is really accurate because here it shows experimental measurement and calculated results. I mean, x-axis is calculated results, and y-axis is experimental measurement. And it's almost perfect. They all lie on this diagonal line. So it's worth computing, really. So what we did in this paper of secret R in physical regulators last year is just virtual screening of low thermal conductivity compounds from database. And first of all, we computed LTC for 101 prototypical compounds, and they are rocks. I mean, their crystal structures have rock salt and zinc blend and BAT type. And among these 101 compounds, the best one, the lowest LTC among these 101 was 0.9 watt per meter Kelvin. And then we went to the Materials Project database. Actually, Materials Project database is made by MIT, so it's very close to here. Yeah. And actually, it's based on the database called ICSD, which is made by Ben in Switzerland. And then they somehow, you know, they added many like values to this database. And the Materials Project database has, you know, is probably the largest resource right now in materials informatics. And what we did is to predict LTC of more than 50,000 compounds in the database. Actually, when you know bioinformatics or chemoinformatics, the number of compounds in this database is very small, actually. For example, for organic compounds, you have a database of, say, 10 million compounds. So that's normal. But right now, for inorganic compounds like metals, ceramics, and so on, the data size is very, very limited. So the material informatics is very, very young, and we have to really develop it further on. By the way, and actually we predicted LTC using Gaussian process method, and we picked up best 8 compounds according to the prediction, and then the five ones had an impressive LTC of smaller than 0.2 watt per meter Kelvin. So this is very impressive value of LTC. I mean, compared to the best one among these prototypes. Actually, these are, you know, I think the smallest value of all known LTC materials. And this table shows the compound actually. These are the compounds we found. And this score stands for the goodness of our prediction. I mean, yeah. And this LTC is actually recomputed after prediction. So we computed Z score for every compound. But we took top ones and then we recomputed LTC. Actually, so therefore LTC is not, you know, so because the top one was, you know, top one in terms of Z-score was 0.1, so it's not actually number one, but it had a very small value. And to actually build a material band gap is also very important factor. So among these 8, band gap was too large. So we just go downwards on the list, and then we found this type of materials with low band gap as well. So we are trying to generate this right now. So this is one case. Okay, and another method I want to introduce is Bayesian optimization method, which is a machine learning method to find best data points with minimum number of observations. I will explain later. And what we want is to choose next point to observe to discover the best ones as early as possible. So this is basically experimental design method, and you want to design experiment optimally to discover the best one as early as possible. And the beginning of Bayesian optimization is the same as virtual screening. So you just compute a few scores. And then what you do next is to compute predictive scores for the rest. But at the same time, you also compute predictive variance. Like this, and predicted variance indicates how reliable your predicted score is. So if variance is large, it's not that reliable. So there can be much error, and if it is small, then you are more confident. And considering predictive score and predictive variance, you choose the next one to observe. And here, observation corresponds to first principles calculation. But when you do real experiments, of course, it can be a real experiment. Okay, and actually, when you don't use predicted variances, then actually it's very hard to design experiment optimally because you tend to go to the same places. So you just you just continue to try very similar compounds, which is obviously not optimal. So you need to take into account uncertainty or confidence of your prediction at the same time. And then if 8 is chosen, material 8 is chosen, then we go on to calculate for material 8. And then we do this again. And how do we choose the optimal candidate for next experiment? I will explain this in this figure. And suppose x-axis is your explanatory variable representing materials, and the y-axis is the measured score, measured value. And suppose you have done already 10 experiments, 10 observations, and the maximum of the best one is that, with this green line. And you have 4 more candidates, so you want to, like these red ones, and you want to choose the next experiment from these 4. And then what you do is to apply a machine learning method called Gaussian process to it. And then because Gaussian process is a Bayesian method, you have this regression function, red one. So this corresponds to predictive score. And in addition to it, you get predictive variance represented as blue lines. And then in Bayesian optimization, what you do is to choose the candidate with maximum probability of improvement. So it means that this chosen one is vertical line have the largest probability of getting better than current maximum. So this is the idea. So you can see that you need actually the variance to compute this kind of this kind of criterion. And actually this is not a new method, it's just used in many tasks. But actually for material science we were the first to apply this. And in the first work we applied it to find the material of highest melting temperature from 226 materials. So this was not very big. And initially, 5% of materials are chosen randomly, and their melting temperatures are observed. And after that, next point to observe is determined by Bayesian optimization, as I explained. Of course, to apply machine learning to materials, you have to have descriptors or feature vectors of each material. And actually, you can derive elemental features very easily, like composition. Composition is just fraction of, so suppose you have A and B atoms, and then fraction of A and B atoms is just composition, an atomic number, atomic mass, and so on. So they are just, you can get it from Wikipedia or something like that. And in addition to that, we also use DFT, density functional theory calculations, to derive features such as cohesive energy, bulk modulus, volume, nearest neighbor pair distance. Nearest neighbor pair distance. And prediction accuracy is something like this. So. For Gaussian processes. And without DFT calculations, without these four features on the left, it had, you know, it was a little worse. And with DFT calculations, it was a little better. And this open circle represents training examples, and the closed circle representation examples. And actually, in this case, x-axis represents experimental truth, and y represents predicted ones. And actually, it's very accurate, right? and normally, when you know, I looked at many material data, but it's much more. The data is very clean compared to biology. You know, in biology, it's very hard to measure some major things like gene expression levels are different from time to time. When you want to measure the same thing in the same condition, it's not, you know, normally it's not possible to measure the same thing in the same condition. But for materials, it's okay.
How do you get the line? Because I think that your training examples will not give a regression like that for the left figure.
The left figure, I mean, sorry, I mean, this is just, you know, x, you know, x-axis represents the ground truth for 226 compounds. So you have 226 circles, and actually, y-axis is our predicted results, you know, so we are just, you know, so it's not a regression function, but we are just comparing prediction against ground truth. You see? So, do you see?
Okay. I have a different question, and that is you're trying to predict high temperature materials, and yet your variation gets worse as you go to higher temperatures. So, is there something you're missing, you think, in the calculations?
Probably, yeah. So, it's basically because we don't have many high temperature data. So, because machine learning is just a statistical thing, if you have, you know, many data points, then the accuracy of this region is very accurate, but very sparse region it's not so accurate. So I think it's simply that.
Is this just metals, or does it include?
It's metals, metals only.
No oxides.
No size. It's just you know, bimetals, like binary compounds of metals. No size. And this is a result of Bayesian optimization. And this figure shows that so the x-axis is the number of materials examined, and the y-axis shows the melting temperature. Best melting temperature so far. So, and red one, red line shows a random experiment. So you just pick up one from 226 metals randomly, and then they measure melting temperature. And then of course it's very slow to get to the metal of highest temperature. But this squeezing or Bayesian optimization, using Bayesian optimization, it's very quick to find the best one. And actually, the number of measurements required to find the solid or metal of highest melting temperature is this. So using random, it's 133. And if we use Bayesian optimization, it's reduced to 16. So this was highly successful. I mean, thinking about it, actually, the random, you know, the average number of measurements for random is just half because the probability of, you know, of the best one being in the first half and the last half is the same. So of course the expectation is exactly the half. And this shows one run of our Bayesian optimization. So this blue was just selected randomly, and up to there we designed, and this aluminum nitride is the best one having highest temperature. Okay.
Sorry, I'm missing something.
Mm-hmm.
You predict in the aluminum nitride has the highest melting temperature of those?
No. I mean, so we, you know, so actually this is a like benchmark studies. So in reality, we know the melting temperature of everything in reality, and we, you know, we applied Bayesian optimization,
yeah,
and see how early we get to aluminum nitride, and I mean to test how Bayesian optimization is. To test how Bayesian optimization works in material science data. So,
but this is not a metal. I thought you mentioned it was only metals that you predict.
Sorry. I mean, maybe it's true. I'm sorry. So there are oxides and so on. Sorry. I'm sorry. I mean, I'm not a physicist, so I'm not a material scientist. So this is a little ambiguous to me. I'm sorry. I'm basically a computer scientist. Yeah.
But calcium oxide and aluminum oxide,
we chose
silicon carbide.
Yeah, we chose this 226 just not so much reason. We actually, you know, copied it from a book because there's no database about this.
Oh, I understand that. I'm just wondering if the as your predictions get worse as you go to higher temperature,
mm-hmm,
they're getting worse because they're not predicting the oxides correctly, or there's some other systematic trend that.
So it might be the case. It might be the case, and actually, in this paper in Physical Review B, So we published a paper in Physical Review B 2 years ago, and you can find it in my homepage. So, and actually, our collaborator did some kind of discussion about this. So maybe if you are interested, please look. But honestly speaking, because I'm a computer scientist, I don't understand it all of the discussions there. And another trial is to, you know, to determine grain boundary structure, and in this case you have a kappa crystal, and you have a crystal of different different direction, different orientation, and they are just, you know, just get together like this, and you want to choose optimal translation parameters dx, dy, dz to minimize the grain boundary energy. So this is very very simple optimization, like black box optimization setting. And actually, you can compute the grain boundary energy using first principles calculations. And the question is how to, you know, how Bayesian optimization accelerates the discovery of the best shift, best translation. And this is actually very, in a sense, very easy problem because you have only three dimensions. And if you have, if you did grid search exhaustive calculations, you need to compute more than 16,000 calculations. And actually, yeah, like that, but applying Bayesian optimization, we found the best grain boundary structure using only 69 calculations on average. So in this case, this was really effective. And actually, you know, for computer science people, it's not so surprising. But this is, you know, when I presented this to you know, computational physicists, it was like very surprising to them. Yeah. And it shows how Bayesian optimization worked in this particular case. And this is 3D space we are searching for. I mean, maybe some lines are missing, but and you can see these numbers. And up to 20, it's red, and it shows random selection. And then from 21, you start Bayesian optimization. And this 69 is the best point. And so this is 69th observation. And actually, yeah, so it's like, you know, they are slowly identifying raw region, and you know, and they finally, you know, go back and forth because these two regions, and then finally found the best one. Okay, so I show another application of Bayesian optimization to material problems. And this is kind of interesting. This is designing nanostructures for non-transport via materials informatics. But in this case, it's also about thermal conductivity. And we want to find out low thermal conductivity and high thermal conductivity materials. But the question is a little different from before. So we consider this kind of alloy consisting of silicon and germanium. And we have two leads on left and right. And in the beginning, you have mixed region. And there are 16 atoms there. And you want to you know, place 8 germanium in this region out of 16. And we measure the thermal, we compute thermal conductance from the, you know, from the left end to right end. And we want to minimize the, we want to set germanium such that the thermal conductivity is minimum or maximum, right? And then actually all the combinations, if you consider all combinations, it's about, the number of combinations is 12,000 and so on. And we described each configuration of germanium like this. So we just put 1 to germanium positions and 0 for silicon positions. That's it. And for calculation of thermal conductivity, we use atomic Green's function and interfacial, you know, to compute interfacial thermal conductance. So we used existing method. And we optimized the structure using Bayesian optimization. And actually, lower figures just show the performance of Bayesian optimization in minimizing and maximizing thermal conductivity. And actually, optimal structures in minimizing were obtained by calculating only 3.4% of all candidates. So this was again successful. And this result was very interesting, you know. And actually, maximizing thermal conductivity was not that interesting because we end up with very regular structure like that. So if you have silicon lead, and then you know all germanium just you know come on the upper half, and then you know, lower half is just silicon. But for minimum conductivity case, this was very interesting because it was aperiodic. So it's not regular. It's very irregular structure. Like you have 4 germanium on the left, and you have 2 and 2 and so on. So yeah, so we have this paper on archive. So we have some discussions here. And we did a slightly different tasks. And here we have 10 layer superlattice structure, 5 layers silicon and 5 layers germanium between silicon lead, and we want to you know optimize it such that the thermal conductance is minimum. And descriptors are very similar, so basically germanium positions are marked in as one. And then again, the base structure was this. So the result was 11010100001. And actually, yeah, so this was again very interesting because this kind of irregular structure could not be designed by humans. So for humans, you know, it's probably difficult to come up with this kind of very irregular ones. But in fact, this is the optimal. And there are several different cases. Okay. And actually, as we work with material scientists, we thought that making a library usable for everybody is very important. So actually, if you can code, for example, Gaussian processes by yourself, it's okay. but of course, practitioners cannot do that. So we implemented so-called common Bayesian optimization Python library or combo. And from machine learning point of view, we have used random feature maps to speed up Gaussian processes because learning Gaussian processes is very actually very slow. Actually, in the worst case, you need cubic time, but because of random feature maps, it's linear time to run. And it has a function to automatically tune hyperparameters, automatically initialize hyperparameters and update hyperparameters by maximizing type 2 likelihood. Because setting hyperparameter is so difficult. So Gaussian processes, for example, have kernel parameters and prior widths, but it's very hard for users to calibrate by themselves. And here we used, we actually approximated GP by the combination of random feature map and Bayesian linear regression. Yeah. So actually, maybe I don't explain this too much, but this approximation by random feature maps is was proposed by Rahimi and Recht in about 10 years ago, and this is very good method for speeding up kernel methods. So normally kernel methods are slow, but if you use this approximation, it's pretty competitive to, for example, deep learning techniques. And this shows computational time of combo in learning from data. And when you use scikit-learn implementation of GP, it's about quadratic. But if we use combo, this is red and green lines, it's just linear time. But it's due to random feature maps. So finally, I'd like to mention a little about RNA inverse folding and application of Monte Carlo tree search to this. It's not a material science problem, but it's more or less a biological problem. As you may know, this RNA is just a single chain of nucleotides, ACGU, and actually it forms secondary structure where A and U bind together, and basically C and G bind together, right? And then the question. And there are many methods to predict the structure of RNA sequence given this sequence. Right? So given this, you can predict the secondary structure using some tool. So there are many tools like RNA fold, centroid fold, and so on and so forth. So this is not so difficult. But the difficult thing is to design RNA sequence such that such that the secondary structure becomes the target structure. So you first specify a target structure, and then you want to have a sequence which results in this target structure. And if you have n nucleotides, you have 4 to the power of n candidates. And the Bayesian optimization cannot be applied in this case, as it is, because you have to compute prediction values for all candidates in Bayesian optimization. So actually, we used Monte Carlo tree search, which was recently used by AlphaGo, or actually it has been used in ComputerGo community for a long time. And in Monte Carlo tree search, you have a search tree like this, and in RNA case, each branch represents assigning one or two characters, one or two nucleotides at some certain position. So the first level corresponds to assigning some nucleotides at position 7 in this case. And the next one corresponds to assigning the pairs to pair positions, for example. And actually, when you go down the tree and when you go, reach a leaf, then you can specify one whole sequence. And you can compute the energy of that one. And one difficult point is you cannot make the whole tree because this is too big. So actually, in Monte Carlo tree search, you keep only shallow top part. So you remember only shallow top part. And actually, when you do search, you have to calculate a score for each intermediate node to guide the search, right? Because if this intermediate node is promising, then you want to visit it, and you want to ignore some nodes which are not promising at all. And the score and actually this is the same in ComputerGo. So given some intermediate state of computer Go play, and then you have to compute how promising you are, like how promising, how likely you win. And to compute the score at the intermediate node, we do playout, so-called playout. And the playout is just traversing the rest of the search tree randomly, just randomly. So. And in our case, we given some intermediate node, we traverse 50 times. So we basically build 50 sequences, RNA sequences, and computes energy, and we just take average of this energy, and add some property penalty, and we make it a score, so-called UCB score of intermediate nodes. And we compared our tool called MCTS RNA against existing tools. Actually, there are many tools of RNA inverse folding, but most of them are using evolutionary algorithms, like genetic algorithms. So there are several, there are too many, actually, evolutionary algorithms. And one is ant-colony optimization, and so on and so forth. And we compared with Antana, which uses ant-colony optimization, and each window corresponds to different GC content constraint. I mean, GC content constraints is just a fraction of G and C in the total sequence, which is because G and C have lower energy, but binding of G and C have lower energy. So if you just optimize energy, then you have too many G and C's. So it's important to control G and C in a pre-specified fraction. And as you can see, we have more successful solutions, and we have more target structures correctly solved. And this is comparison with other methods called ERD and modern. Okay. So on this, this is conclusion. Actually, this talk was actually a collection of different applications of machine learning algorithms. And the machine learning algorithms are not so, I mean, we only just used like existing algorithms to solve material science problems. But actually, they were very good and seems to be very impressive to material scientists because I don't know why, but in material science, application of machine learning is not done really. And actually, Aspel Guzik, Professor Aspel Guzik here in Harvard, was very active in doing this. I mean, I met a student in this group in this morning. So, but this group is really exceptional, and still, you know, still the majority of them are not so much familiar with it. And actually, what we have found is that these artificial intelligence techniques or machine learning techniques combined with first principles calculation is very, very powerful. And actually, it's very, I think the material informatics is really promising. And it will, I think, continue to grow in this years, like several years, to be more prominent, and so if you are interested, please talk to me and let's, you know, study together. Thank you very much.
Process the lattice data in the database. I'm wondering if you could quantify what you mean by large.
I mean, you know, computing for one material takes 1 week. So basically, for processing the whole database, you need 50,000 weeks. So that's large. Yeah. So actually, if scanning is 1 week, it's not large, I would say. But yeah. And actually, it depends on the, you know, the method you choose. So you can choose a fast calculation method, less accurate calculation method, and then it could be faster. But you know, so there are two ways to make it faster. So one is to use fast, you know, fast principle calculation method, or using machine learning. And in my experience, using machine learning is much more effective, you know, comparing accuracy and speed. So in a sense, machine learning is a way to, you know, another way to accelerate the computation, you know. So it's either you compromise physically, or you can compromise statistically by machine learning. So it's anyway compromisation. But statistical compromisation is sometimes much more effective than compromise, like physically, like using less accurate approximation of reality. Okay. Yeah. So. Yeah.
Do you have experimental tests for the germanium silicon?
Not yet. I mean, we actually submitted this paper last month, so we haven't done this yet. But according to my collaborator, this might be possible to make. Yeah, this is make or, you know, generate really, you know, in reality. Can you? But yeah, so I cannot imagine how we can do this, but yeah, because it's only like 5 layers of atoms, so it means, you know, it's really precise. And I think you might have the similar problems. You know, this is just one case, but. Hi.
Thanks for the talk, it's very interesting. Oftentimes when you use the Bayesian optimization, you're trying to find the max or the min of some property. But when you are actually prospecting, you don't know what the max or the min is. So in the studies you've shown, you know how long it took to find that.
Yeah, so because this is kind of benchmark study, because we, in this case also, we computed, actually, you know, we really computed all possibilities.
Right. So the question I have is, do you have some ideal heuristic when you're trying to use it to find, like when you stop, basically, when you don't know what you
know? So basically, you know, when it stops improving, say like 300 trials, then finish or something. And then, of course, you have to determine the duration of waiting. And I think there are such studies in machine learning, you know, based on, for example, some statistical models, you can somehow measure how likely you are to find beta one, probably. But yeah, but this type of study is not so common, I think. So we need to figure out. But in the end, you know, even if you have some machine learning solution, this has to be based on some model. So you know, ultimately we have to try them all if you really want to find the optimal one. But I think basically in many cases, you know, you don't need to find the absolutely the best one. Or something, yeah. So I think it depends on the problem. Yeah.
All your examples of, except for the RNA at the end, were calculations of properties that depend very much on temperature.
Yeah. Yes.
So were all these calculations done for a fixed real temperature or a fixed Dubai temperature? Because the correlation you showed earlier on between calculated and actual thermal conductivity, the straight line for Wurtzeit and others, is actually at different temperatures, but always the same Dubai temperature. So that's part of the question. The other part is, we would always be interested in doing this for a whole range of temperatures, because very few materials are very useful at room temperature, for instance, except for materials.
Sure. Yeah, actually, I have to check our paper to answer. I mean, answer if this is like you know, computed at zero Kelvin or other temperature. And yeah, actually, we can. I mean, so there are many, you know, possible applications of Bayesian optimization. And actually, yeah, of course, we can just, you know, also optimize temperature, probably. But maybe it's not, you know, optimizing temperature, probably. So maybe temperature comes into our, you know, our evaluation functions. So yeah. So actually, we need to model it, first of all. So modeling process is necessary. And then we consider how to apply Bayesian optimization. So it depends. You know, when I talk to material scientists, this is the most difficult part. So what is, you know, how to translate your needs to machine learning is, you know, very variable. So it's not just, you know, having one method and solve them all. It's not the case.
Thank you.